You were the chosen ones. Let me explain to you what that means. Your leadership qualities have impacted our school in a positive way, and we need you to build more leadership qualities so that we move on in pursuit of making Edsel Ford the number one high school in Dearborn. Today, we will be talking about emerging leadership. And when we speak about emerging leadership, there are certain characteristics that we feel the student body at Edsel Ford High School definitely possesses. And we want to nurture it. We want to put more emphasis on active engagement by all students. So today, it's going to be a wonderful experience. You will be doing some activities, so we're not going to bore you with speeches. But however, we have some very important people with us today. They're taking time from their busy schedule, not only to show support to Edsel Ford High School, but also to engage us in a message of unity, a message of perseverance, and a message that says, you know, we're here for our future leaders. You are the future leaders of this city. You are the future leaders of this country. And I told Ms. Rivet and David Mustonen, whom I would like to acknowledge and give them a big round of applause for helping us put this thing together. I told them, I promise you, I will not eat up more time at the mic. Jackie, it's all yours to introduce everybody, and thank you so much again.
Good morning, everybody. I recognize some of you from either peer mediation, from elementary school when you were in elementary school, and the Dearborn Lions cheerleaders. So a lot of you are very familiar faces to me, but you're a lot older than you used to be. I don't know how you got older and I got younger, but it worked out that way, and I'm real happy to see that. As Mr. Jaffers said, you are a selected group of people. You are a very special group of people because you're going to return to your school and you're going to be ambassadors for the core values, for the golden rule, and for leadership. People are going to look up to you as leaders in your school, and we're going to try to help give you some skills today that you can take back and share with other students at Edsel Ford High School. I'd like to have my friend David Mustonen come up here, and he's going to make some introductions. And they told me that I couldn't talk and make everybody cry, so I'm just going to turn the mic over to Mr. Mustonen.
Okay, thank you, Jackie. Hi, everybody. I'm David Mustonen. I'm the communications coordinator here in the district, and I guess we'll get things going, and I'm going to have the privilege, actually, to be able to introduce you to the person who, you know, we all have, we all know Mr. Jaffer is the leader of Edsel Ford High School, and I'm sure that many of you have seen Dr. Artis, who is the leader of this entire district. And Dr. Artis has really, during his time here, has spent a great deal of time developing leaders that will lead our schools. He also, you know, teaches classes at the university level doing just that. So when it comes to building leaders and talking about leadership, I think that Dr. Artis is very well suited to do that. So without wasting any more time, Dr. Artis.
Thank you very much, David, for the introduction, and thank you, Mr. Jaffer, for inviting me to be a part of this experience. And for you, the audience who are going to be the major participants in this experience, thank you for being here. You know, part of leadership is showing up. If you don't show up, you certainly can never be a leader. So part of leadership is showing up. So you've already taken your first step. You've showed up. And for that, we are grateful. For that, we are pleased. For that, we will be proud. We're very certain of that. Another part of leadership is dedication. Dedication to a set of principles. Dedication to more than just yourself, but to also helping and supporting other people. And I suspect that if we did a review of all of the different things that each of you have done in your lifetime, we find that you've already begun to understand that, that dedication is an important part of leadership. Another part of leadership is the willingness to sacrifice and persevere under hard times. Not everything comes easy. Not everything happens immediately. Not everything is particularly easy to live through. But the reality is that that's what leaders have to do. They have to be willing to be dedicated. They have to be willing to take the time to live and to be patient with allowing others to come to the positions that they're articulating and identifying. I would also indicate to you that from my perspective, leadership is something that can be learned. It's not something you're born with necessarily. It's something that you can learn. It's something that you can learn how to become better at. It's something that you can learn how to, in fact, excel at. But you don't have to be born to be a leader. It can be developed. So you may be saying to yourself as you're sitting here, I'm not sure whether I can do everything that all of these people are going to be asking of me. Well, the fact of the matter is that we have confidence in you because we know that you can learn. And we know that you can get a sense of leadership and be able to share that with other people. There's a president of this country that once stood before a crowd and used a quote that he paraphrased called John F. Kennedy, who said, ask not what your country can do for you, but ask what you can do for your country. Well, in essence, that's what we're asking of you for Edsel Ford. Ask not what Edsel Ford can do for you, but what you can do for Edsel Ford. How you can help Edsel Ford become a better place, become a safer place, become a place where everyone feels that they have a legitimate chance to succeed and where there's a sense of belonging. That's what we're asking of you. So, leaders of Edsel Ford, thank you for having me here. Have a wonderful day, and I know that you're going to have some incredible experiences. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Artis. Appreciate those good words. Well, as all of us here today are very different in how we feel and how we look and how our attitudes are and our views are, so do leaders come in many different varieties and take on many different roles. Dr. Artis as leader of all of our schools, Mr. Jafer is leader of Edsel Ford, and today we are also joined by president of our school board, who is also a leader, an elected leader for and represents the citizens in Dearborn as a member of our Board of Education. And I'd like to introduce and have her come up and say a few words, our president of the Board of Education, Ms. Sharon Dalmage.
Good morning. And see, I wore Edsel colors today on purpose. I just want to thank you all for coming here this morning. And I know that you were chosen because you are very special people. And we know that you can help your wonderful principal move forward. And I am so excited about that. I also would like to say good morning to one of your teachers that many of you have, who's been my friend, my dear friend for over 30 years. Miss Ryder is in this room back here. What is a leader? A leader is someone who has people follow them because they want to follow them and not by bullying them to follow them. I guess that's a pretty easy way to say it. There's a lot of qualities that leaders have. They have vision. They have the ability to direct. They have the ability to move people along and have them want to do the right thing. And they set the example. And I think that's real important. But I borrowed something from Ms. Reve's office today, and I promise I'll return it to her. But this is something else that a leader is. It's one of my very favorite animals is a giraffe. And I know this seems really funny, but a giraffe is a very tall person or tall thing, and it sticks its neck out all the time. And it keeps its head above all the stuff that's swirling around its feet and is able to move forward and see clearly and see above and see ahead of other things. And I think a giraffe is sort of like a leader because it doesn't let all the little things get in the way. It just keeps moving on and doing what it has to do. And a leader also has heart. And I think that's an important thing to learn. And I think all of you in here are here because you know the right things to do, and you were chosen because you have the ability and the qualities to move Edsel Ford forward and have people follow you because they want to follow you. Good leaders are people friendly, they're good listeners, they're innovative, they're accountable, they're focused, they're interested in the ideas of others, which means they listen, they're very open, they can be tough. They don't badger people, they don't bully people. People move in the direction that the leaders take them. And so today, my challenge is to all of you to make Edsel Ford the very best school in the district. And I know that it can be because you have an excellent leader in your building. Thank you very much, and I will certainly be watching this to see what happens. And I just need to say I am so proud of each and every one of you for being here today.
Yes.
Thank you, President Dalmadge. You know, leaders are tasked with being leaders for different reasons. Dr. Artis, leader of our district, is here to lead the educational focus of this district and lead all the students in this district. We have a leader here today from the city of Dearborn whose leadership, whose role as a leader is to save lives and to save property within our city. And that's an awesome responsibility that comes with being a leader. And I would like to introduce our fire chief from the city of Dearborn, Chief Hazim.
Good morning. Sharon just mentioned her giraffe and how it stands at a certain height and looks in the future and beyond and not worried about all the little things around it. And that's so important. I like to look at, if you want to compare it to another animal, is an eagle. An eagle is something that's quiet, it stays focused, and it soars. The flip side of that is a duck. A duck likes to quack a lot, and it does other things and make messes around. So those are things that we don't want to do. We definitely want to focus on being an eagle or a giraffe in Sharon's case here. So those are some things to remember. And, you know, and we just don't wake up in the morning and come up with this stuff. These are things that we're taught as leaders throughout the community, through all the leaderships that I've taken or leadership courses that I've taken. They teach you things, and there's a lot of comparable things that they try to relate to leadership styles and techniques. And so that's what I bring back to my department, and I share that with my senior officers and let them take that to their next in-line command lieutenants and then all the way down to firefighters. So that's how our structure of our department works. So I have to take advantage of that. My job as the fire chief, I'm responsible for all four stations and all personnel that come along with that. Overnight, I was literally responsible for 8 firefighters at 1 station, 1 crew, and we were having a great time. We were training hard. We were a busy station, and I was really enjoying my job. And the mayor approached me and said, "Nazay, I think I'd like you to be the chief." And I was just overwhelmed. I couldn't sleep for 3 days. That was such an eye-opener for me and such a responsibility, and I wasn't sure within myself if I was willing to take on that task. So I really had to do a lot of soul-searching, not just with myself, but with my family, with my wife. I needed to bring people that loved me and supported me throughout my career to lean on them and say, you know, is this something I should really take on? So literally overnight, responsible for 8 firefighters to 120 firefighters, and all the equipment and all the personnel issues and the budget and everything else that falls into that position. So that was quite a undertaking on my part, and I was overwhelmed at first, but I don't regret it now. The department's great, and it's moving in the right direction. We have good leadership. And I'm sharing this with you because these are goals that I had to establish early on in my career, and these are goals that you should be thinking about. You are handpicked for the summit, and I think that's wonderful. That's something to be very proud of. You know, and we have such a diverse audience here, which is also phenomenal. But that is what our community is made of, a very diverse population. Our department is very diverse. My fire department is. So we have different cultures that we need to understand. That's part of our responsibility, is looking out into our community, understanding different cultures and respecting different cultures. We do that because we have to save lives. And a part of our job is not only for us to understand the different cultures that we have to serve in the community and understanding it and respecting it, but we also have to educate the community on the culture of the fire department. It's amazing how many people don't understand what we do within the fire department, how we respond, how we treat patients. So it's part of our job to get them to understand that as well. So it works both ways. Everybody needs to understand everybody's position and whatever it is they choose to do throughout their careers. So I think this is a great program that we're starting here today, and I'm really proud to be asked to be here and to be in front of you today and speaking. So I'm going to be here for the next 2.5 hours, and hopefully we'll have some open dialogue, and any questions you have, or no matter what kind of a question it is, go ahead and ask me. I'll be more than happy to sit down with you and talk to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chief. I just want to mention, too, that you know, there are a number of people who have joined us here today, and as well as Ms. Dalmage, who is our board president. Ms. Petchlikoff is a member of our Board of Education as well, our newest member of the Board of Education, so we thank her for being here as well in her leadership role.
And I'm also an Edsel parent.
More importantly, she's an Edsel parent, absolutely. We've heard from leaders who are leading the educational process in our schools, and the chief who leads the fire department. But leaders have many different roles, and they lead different groups of people. And just quickly, I hope that we can have Ms. Connie Lyon come up and just say hello and welcome, as she is was president of the PTSA, the Parents Association here in the district, and is also a member of the PTSA Council. So, Connie?
Good morning, Thunderbirds. Mr. Mustin, he was supposed to introduce me after Sharon, and he started to say how this next guest was, or speaker was, saving lives, and I'm thinking, wow, I didn't realize I had such an impact on this community. But I have been involved in the PTSA for quite a long time in this district. I am a parent at Edsel Ford, a very proud parent. I'm also the PTSA president there at Edsel Ford, as well as in the council. The PTSA Association is a child advocacy group, and we make children number one. We have a legislative office in Washington, D.C., where we lobby for quality education. We also initiate laws to protect our children and to provide a safe environment for you to live, learn, and to grow. Someone once said that great leaders aren't born, they're cultivated. And I know that there's two important qualities that leaders possess, and that is a drive to succeed and the willingness to get involved. The rest can be learned, and I am very confident that each and every one of you here this morning has the potential to be a great leader, and I would hope that you will go forward from today and lead by example to make good choices and to make Edsel Ford the very best high school, and I know that you can do it. I'm thankful to be here today and to share with you in this experience. Thank you.
Thank you, Connie. All right, we are going to start, before we start our first activity here, and I'm going to turn it back over to Jackie, I just wanted to acknowledge that there are a number of other folks who are here today. Mr. Ernie Oz has joined us, who is a parent leader in our district as well. Several of the folks who work here in this central office who are leaders of their departments and throughout this district have joined us as well. And we have parents who are here who want to be part of this, and they too are our role models and leaders in our community and within just in within their families as well. So that's enough said from me and from all of us here, and I'm going to turn it back over to Jackie and we can get going with some activities.
Okay. There is some newsprint. If you folks can pass out two sheets to every table, then I'll explain the activity. As the fire chief said, we have a lot of differences in our community. That's what makes our community so wonderful. We have a great mixture of people. And sometimes something that causes problems within an office, within a school, within a community is we don't know about the other person. We don't know about their likes, their dislikes. We just think that they're different from us. We don't know them, so we're not going to be friends with them. This activity that you're going to do is about commonalities and differences. And what you're going to do, you all hear me? I've got a loud enough voice. At your table, you're going to work with your partners at your table, and I'm going to use this pad of paper to show you what you're going to do. You're going to draw. Okay, now I'm not much of an artist, so I need to be really easy at it. Since I can't do it, I'm not going to ask you to do it. See, you're already my friend. You're going to make a donut, okay? Oh, I think you can all do this. You're going to make a donut, and you're going to talk amongst the people at your own at your table. Some of you go to Edsel Ford, but you not, may not even know the people that you're sitting with. So you're going to talk amongst the people at your table, and you're going to come up with all the things you have that are similar. Like, you all have gone to Cedar Point, or you all have brothers and sisters. You all had Mr. Tyler. You all think Mr. Tyler's awesome. Then you have differences. And the differences go in here, in the inside of the, like in the donut hole. So maybe some of the differences could be some of you have pets, some of you don't. Some of you drive a car, some of you don't. Some of you wear underwear, and some of you don't. So, you know, that was... you don't have to go quite that far. But just to show that we do have... differences, but we also have commonalities. It doesn't matter how many you have in either circle, okay? So we're going to give you, there's markers on your table. You have what, two pieces of paper. We're going to use the other one later on this morning. So take your paper and draw your circles, draw your donut, and start this activity, and then we're going to talk about it after you work on this. So does, is there anybody that doesn't understand the activity? Y'all understand it? Good. Thank you. right. You can all put your pens down, put the caps on them. And we're going to start. And everybody, each table is going to share one commonality and one difference. Okay? And I'm going to start at this table right here and list a name a commonality and then name a difference, okay? Go ahead, Lindsay.
Wait 1 second here. You got to stand up. Okay, we've all been locked out of our car and not all of us have gone ice skating.
Yeah, one that you have in common and one that is different. And you have to stand up.
I do?
Yeah.
We all like sports and we all went to different middle schools.
Wow. All right.
We all want to be good leaders and then we play different sports at school.
Very good.
Not everyone plays a sport at school, I'm sorry.
But you all want to be leaders. That's awesome.
We all want to attend college, and not all of us were born here.
Okay. Not all of you were born here in Dearborn. Okay. Good. Students, speak up louder. You're going to do it? All right.
Okay.
There's a leader right there.
For similarities, we're not all vegetarians. And for differences, not all of us lit our garage on fire.
Our what?
Our garage on fire.
Oh, okay. Who would like to do it? All right. Real loud.
We all like music, but some of us don't like clowns, so. They're scary.
I was just. Clowns can be very scary.
We all have been to another country and we all don't drive.
Very good. Okay, who's the leader?
Our major priority is success and we all don't like shopping.
Awesome. Your major priority is success. That's great. Who's at this table?
All of us like Florida, and not all of us like to read, very unfortunately.
I mean, not very good that you don't like to read, but good answers. Okay. Yeah, your principal didn't hear that. You're the leader. All right.
We all plan to go to college, and not all of us have been out of state.
Good. Very good. A lot of college-bound people. You're the leader?
The differences are we all have different races and religions, and our similarities are we've all been on a roller coaster.
Okay, very good. Thank you.
Our similarities are we all have all traveled, and our differences are we all don't have pets.
Okay. So you can see that we have lots of things in common. I see on the papers, which I hope you take back to your school and maybe you can put them up and write on the top and on the bottom similarities and differences so that you can see and are reminded that we do have a lot of things that make us different. And that's great. We don't all want to be the same. When I do a peer mediation training with an elementary school, and I'll say, what if you all woke up tomorrow morning and everybody looked like me? Well, they're, oh, and you know, they get all panicky. But how boring would that be? If you all woke up and you came to school and we all look like each other and it just happened to be that you all look like me. That would be a very boring place. So it's wonderful to have differences. It's wonderful to be unique. But it's also fun to look and see what we have in common. We have so many things in common, but we don't know it because we don't know one another. We walk past each other in the hallway. We do that here at this building. You know, we don't know a lot about each other. It's just the way things are today. We're human doings. We're not human beings all the time. You know, we're doing on the go, go, go. So remember, the next time you are feeling different, that you do have things in common with your fellow classmates at Edsel Ford. If you know, and remember that other people may be feeling different and may not feel included. And try to include them. All right. Now I'm going to have you move around a little bit. Okay? So let's draw a line down the middle of this room. There's two rows of tables on this side and two rows of tables on this side. Now, we're kind of scrunched, but that just means we're really friendly people and we don't mind standing close to our neighbor. What you're going to do is you're going to line up. Some of you may have done this. And let me explain before I tell you what the activity is. Body language. How many of you know what body language is? Okay. Can you explain what body language is? Very good. Using your face, how you move. So if I came to your school and I was coming into your classroom, and I came in like this, very, very mean, yes. But if I came in, la, 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 with, well, weird, yes, that would be weird. I was going for something else, though. Nice, funny, okay. We don't sometimes pay. David's laughing because that is how I walk around here a lot of times, and he thinks I'm weird. We don't pay attention to people's body language. And it's really important. If mom and dad are like sitting, you know, paying their bills at the kitchen table and they've got a scowl on their face and sweat's pouring down and they're like worrying and they're, you know, putting their hand on their head, that's probably not a good time to ask for $50 to go to the mall. So that's an important time to pay attention to body language. Also, let's say you're at school and you're running down the hall because you're late for a class and you see Mr. Jaffer very quietly standing at the end of the hall. Pardon me? Turn right. Exactly. Not a good time to maybe make a joke or, you know, try to get yourself out of it. It would probably be a good idea to turn right or stop, slow down, apologize, say, oh, I'm sorry for running. I'm late for class. We don't do this all the time. And we don't pay attention to people's body language. And so what we're going to do is an exercise with nonverbal communication. Now, as teenagers, we like to talk. What am I saying? We all like to talk. I'm not a teenager, and I love to talk. We like to talk, but it's easy to talk and express how we feel sometimes. It's very hard to let somebody know how we're feeling when we can't say anything. So what you're going to do is, like I said, we've broke up the room, and you're going to somehow, like this group in this little area, you're going to line up by your birth month and the day you were born. So, but you can't talk, and you have to line up in order. So you have to figure out a way to use something other than verbal communication to line up in order. Do you understand? Can't talk. Mm-mm. And when I say can't talk, nonverbal, don't do this. No, you cannot do that. I always get some Weisenheimer that is, you know, and I was like, no. You have to figure out another way to communicate. Now, this group will have a little teeny area, well, right here, the aisleway. You can use that. You're going to have about 10 minutes to do this. 10 minutes, maybe less, but it when you see, it's harder than you think, okay? So, get up. One poor lone soldier, but his pal's gonna help him out. Help him out. What a nice guy. There you go. That's what I like to see. That's teamwork, leadership. That's awesome. Very good. Okay. Now, do we have three groups? Is this a little group, your own group? Okay. So let's start with this young man and say your birth month and date. We'll see how it goes. Say it real quick.
Are you in front of me?
Yeah. June 17th.
Oh, June 23rd.
June 24th.
July 7th.
July 12th.
July 16th.
August 24th.
August 25th.
August 27th.
September 1.
September 7th.
September 12th.
September 13th.
September 16th.
September 19th.
September 30th.
October 14th.
October 1st.
Uh-oh. That's okay. There we go. Okay.
October 1st.
October 1st.
October 14th.
November 28th.
December 16th.
December 16th.
December 18th.
December 21st.
December 29th.
Is this awesome or what? Very good. Give them a great big round of applause. That is a huge group, and that was great. Just one little snafu. Okay, now this is a group of students from Salina, and they're their own little group. So I'm just going to give you the mic, and you pass it down, okay?
January 25th.
February 11th.
February 18th.
February 19th.
July 17th.
June 5th.
July 1.
July 4th.
August 8.
August 26.
October
29. Very good. Everybody's entitled to have a little, you know, glitch. All right. We're going to start here.
December 23rd. Yeah.
Oh. Oh. Oh, my goodness. I should have worn flat shoes. Okay. The people behind the curtain.
January 3rd.
February 1st.
February
3rd.
February 18th.
February 21st.
February 25th.
March 1st.
March 1st.
March 8th.
March 10th.
March 14th.
March 20th.
April 15th.
April 21st.
April 28th.
May 11th.
May 28th.
May 28th.
June 1st.
June 6th.
June 6th.
June 25th.
July 19th.
August 10th.
September 14th.
September 9th.
September 28th.
October 1st.
November 4th.
November 9th.
November 25th.
December 19th.
December 21st.
December 22nd.
December 23rd.
You did a fabulous job, you guys, because this room isn't really set up to do this exercise. All right. As I said, you guys did a great job because this room isn't really set up for that. And I think one of the hardest things, other than moving around, and making room is not communicating, not talking. That is so hard. But sometimes what we need to do is we need to think before we speak. Think before we say something out of anger, out of, you know, resentment. And we don't do that. We don't do that either. So this lesson teaches us to pay attention to body language. Granted, you're not going to be in your home standing and lining up and telling everybody your birth date. But pay attention at school, at home, people's body language. Do they look, you know, happy? Do they look relaxed? Do they look sad? If you see somebody that's sad, maybe, if they're at lunch and they are eating all by themselves, go over and sit down and eat with them. You got to kind of get out of your comfort zone, move out of the box. And also, think before you act, think before you speak. You know, a closed foot or a closed mouth gathers no foot. And I have a little sign over my desk that says that because I have a very hard time, you know, really thinking about what I say. Sometimes before I just let it blurt out and then I think, oh, I didn't mean it that way or oh. So, you know, think before you speak. Now, what we're going to do is we have a speaker coming, a very, very well-known speaker. It's the former mayor of Detroit. And actually, today they would probably, if they people live in Detroit, are wishing that he was back in Detroit as the mayor. But he'll be coming and speaking. So we don't want to get up and disturb the speaker. So I'm going to give you a break. So you need to be back in your seats by 9:25. We have a very distinguished keynote speaker with us today, the former mayor of Detroit, Dennis Archer. And David's going to say a few words about him, and then we will go right on to Mayor Archer's speech. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you, Jackie. You know, I had the privilege of hearing Mr. Archer speak to some students at the Career Center last year, and I was always impressed with what he has accomplished, but then after I had heard him speak, I was even more impressed. Mayor Archer, before being mayor of the city of Detroit, was a state of Michigan Supreme Court judge, and he was actually named one of the most trusted judges by the Michigan Bar Association. So talk about a man with high morals and integrity. You have it right here. So I'm going to end this and turn this over to Mayor Archer and let him continue on with his story. So welcome, Mayor Archer.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity to be here.
I was advised when I was invited that I was going to have an opportunity to address some very bright, inquisitive leaders, that the young people that I'd have the opportunity to speak before would be diverse, and that you've had some challenges individually and collectively by and with your peers. And so I thought I would share a little bit about who I am, that is to say how I got started, and to perhaps cause you to make an adjustment in terms of how you think through in your thought process in terms of what you want to do with your life. I had planned to be here a little bit earlier, but I volunteered to be an honorary chair for the Red Cross. They're having a fundraiser tomorrow, and I was out at Channel 2 with a young man who is being honored tomorrow evening. He's 9 years old. His mother works for a cardiac healthcare service, a clinic, and because of her work and his interest in what she did, when he was about 6 years old, he asked his mother about the Heinrich maneuver. That is to say, when somebody swallows something, it gets caught in their throat and they can't breathe. She taught him how to do that. And just recently, at 9 years old, in a lunchroom, his classmate turned purple and could not breathe. And so he implemented the Heinrich maneuver and caused what was lodged in his throat to pop out, and thus he is now alive. Because he was inquisitive, because he listened to his mother, and he's a very bright young guy. During your life, there may be an opportunity for you to demonstrate your knowledge, your leadership, and to make a difference in the lives of others. Whether you are elected to represent a student body or some other form of leader in your world of work upon graduation from high school and college, what you do and how you handle yourself and what you contribute will have a huge influence on others and will cause you to take a look at yourself in the mirror and to determine whether you have taken every advantage of an opportunity to learn. I was born in the city of Detroit, and at the age of 5 years, I moved to a village called Cassopolis, Michigan. It's about 187 miles from here. Population about 1,500 people. That's 1,500. Cassopolis was a stop on the Underground Railroad. The Underground Railroad meaning a place where people would stop who were coming up from the South trying to escape slavery as they made their way to the city of Detroit and into Canada. When I was growing up in Detroit during my first 5 years of life, I did not really like to take baths. As a youngster who liked to play a lot, I found it an inconvenience to take a bath. When I moved to Cassopolis, I learned to appreciate a bath, because when I moved to Cassopolis, we did not have running water in our home. we had a well that caught rainwater, and rainwater is not something that you can drink. But my mother used it to wash dishes, and we used it to take a bath. And if you have no running water inside your home, it means you cannot go to a faucet and turn on the water and get a drink of water, nor can you take a bath in a bathtub, nor can you go to the bathroom in a toilet, because there is none inside of a house or a home that does not have running water. I started working at the age of 8. My first job was a caddy on the golf course. Set pins in a bowling alley. Did a lot of different odd jobs. I worked because at that young age, because we were very poor. If you read about standards of living and you hear about people living below poverty and not having a lot, I oftentimes share with people that we were so poor that we could not pay attention. And so, got a witness. There were times that my dad went to the Department of Social Services. I didn't know what that meant. I found out later when I grew up that he went to the welfare office to get some monetary help. Because you see, my dad had a third grade education. He lost his arm just below his left elbow in a car accident before I was born. And because he had a third grade education and was physically handicapped, he couldn't find a good paying job. My mother had a high school diploma, Cassopolis being 1,500 people. They didn't have a lot that you could do. And they didn't have what we have today in the law called the Americans with Disability Act, ADA. So he worked for a gentleman by the name of Fern Westcott, who owned a tool and die shop in South Bend, Indiana. South Bend, Indiana, where Notre Dame is, the university, is 24 miles from Cassopolis, Michigan. Elkhart, Indiana, they had a number of trailer factories where they built trailer factories, but my dad couldn't work there because he was handicapped. So he worked for this gentleman, Fern Westcott, who owned a tool and die shop. And he took care of his summer home on Diamond Lake. Diamond Lake was in Cassopolis. And those of us of color who happened to be black could not own property on Diamond Lake. And when, excuse me, I need to turn this off. And when I went out to, I could go out and visit my dad while my dad was working. But that lake was a beautiful lake. And I couldn't swim in it. Neither could any of my friends who happened to be black. When I grew up, we didn't have, until a little bit later in my life, a television. Didn't have a telephone. But I will tell you, one of the great things that really happened in my life was I had two great parents. A father who taught me how to work with electricity, taught me how to start and raise a garden, which I did during the summer and sold the extra fruit and vegetables. And a mother who was loving and caring, who had a high school diploma. From time to time, she might babysit for somebody. Those two wonderful people made it very clear to me, while they had never stepped foot on a college campus anywhere, that I was going to go to college. They also made it very clear to me that the teachers were absolutely always right. I will tell you that even though we didn't have a telephone, if something happened at school that somehow someone thought I might have been involved in something, they heard about it before I got home. When we had parent-teachers conferences and my mother went up to the school, she expected to see some of my work on the blackboard. And if it wasn't there, I heard about it. They instilled in me great values, which is to be respectful of people, to appreciate how to say yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am, and yes, sir, and no, sir, and to understand that while we didn't have a lot of money, didn't have much at all, frankly, that if you wanted something, you worked for it and you saved it. And that the thing that would help me acquire whatever it is that I wanted, that I would need an education. And if I got an education, that I could do pretty much whatever my potential happened to be. And so when I graduated from Cassopolis High School, I lied about my age to go work in a furniture factory there. They found out that I was too young. They fired me, which was appropriate, and I moved back to Detroit to stay with my grandmother. And I started working at a drugstore as a stock boy, and then I went to Henry Ford Hospital to work part-time as a medical records clerk. And I started Wayne State University. I ultimately graduated from Western Michigan University in Kalamazoo, Michigan. And when I went there, I thought I wanted to be a high school teacher. I wanted to teach history. And for the first time in my life, I had a great counselor who indicated that I would probably not be able to teach high school history because there were so many outstanding teachers who already taught history, that if I were lucky, I might be able to teach history in a junior high school. But why didn't I give some thought, since education was on my mind, as to what subject matter I might teach? And so I went back to the dorm. It's the first time I ever stayed away from home in college. And the dorm was called Vandercook Hall. It was a less expensive dorm that I could stay in. It didn't serve food. It was nicknamed Hungry Hall. And that's because we were always hungry, as you might imagine. And I went back to the room, and I never met the roommate before, but he had a stack of letters like that from different boards of education all across the state of Michigan. So I asked others, who's my roommate? Turned out to be George Waters from River Rouge, Michigan. So what's his area? And they said he was teaching special education for the educable mentally retarded. Today, those students are referred to as learning disabled. So I thought about it, asked a lot of questions. I went back to the counselor, and that's what I majored in. I graduated from Western Michigan University. I came to the city of Detroit, and I started teaching. And I was at Bunch Elementary, and the principal there thought that I did so well with my students and interacted so well with the teachers with whom we worked together on behalf of the students who went to Bunch Elementary. She encouraged me to get a master's degree so I might become a principal. And I started taking two classes at the University of Michigan in the Rackham building, which is where they taught these classes, down at the, near the DIA. And the two textbooks that I used in both classes were the same textbooks that I used at Western Michigan University when I was getting my degree in education. So I was dating this teacher, and I kept complaining, why am I going here to take and use the same two textbooks, and I'm not learning anything different? We had some great teachers at Western. She said, why don't you go to law school? I said, I don't know anything about law. I don't know any lawyers. I've never been in a lawyer's office. I don't even know what they do. I mean, I have some sense of it, but I don't think so. And the more I complained about it, these classes, the more she kept saying, why don't you go to law school? So I took a test, a law school admissions test, and the score came back and suggested that if I went to law school, I'd be successful. I started law school, fell in love with the law, and I did the smartest thing that I perhaps ever could have done, and that is I married the teacher who suggested that I go to law school. We've been married 40 years. We'll be 41 this coming June. I share all of that with you because I want you to understand that I didn't, and I was not born with this suit on, and I was not born into having a lot of things. I was poor. But we had great values in my home. I learned how to respect people. And that's what's helped me in my life. You see, the world that you live in today is a very, very interesting and complex, but yet very simple world. Demographically, as I look around this room and I look at different dress, I appreciate the fact that in the metropolitan area of the city of Detroit, we have over 141 different languages spoken. That's because we are blessed to have so many wonderful people from all parts of the world who, for various reasons, gravitated and came to this metropolitan area. If you take a look at the demographics of the United States, we have just over 300 million people. Just over 30% of us happen to be people of color. The largest single ethnic minority group in the United States happens to be Hispanic or Latino, followed then by African Americans, followed then by all of the other great ethnic groups in the United States. Here in Michigan and in the metropolitan area of Detroit, we have the largest population of people from the Middle East with Middle Eastern background than anywhere outside of the Middle East itself. Los Angeles is second. The world in which we live in, is majority people of color. If we had somebody here from China and India, Japan, Indonesia, Philippines, from the continent of Africa, and you added up the great population of all of that, you would find that the majority of people living in this world are people of color. Remember, I said, in the United States, we've got 300 million people who live in the United States, 300 million, and just over 30% of us are people of color. If a demographer came in and counted the people of color, does anyone doubt for 1 minute that they would not count the person from China? In China, they have 1.3 billion people. 1 billion people more than we have in the United States. In India, over a billion people. And then when you start adding up Pakistan and Japan and Indonesia, the Philippines, and all of these great individual countries, and you add up the population, you soon conclude that the world in which we live in is already majority people of color. If you have some spare time to read, I would ask you to read Thomas Friedman's book, This World is Flat. In this book, Thomas Friedman will tell you, and he's a prolific writer, he is a syndicated columnist, he writes in the New York Times, and he also appears in our Detroit papers. In that book, you will find that as a result of the internet and our ability to communicate with each other in any part of the world, just like that, that this world is basically flat. He comments on what you may hear about at the dinner table, or if you read the news or the newspapers, or if you listen to the news on radio or watch the news on television. We learn a lot about outsourcing, those words, outsourcing and things of that nature, then you find out that businesses send people or send their jobs or new business over to other countries. We learn about the manufacturing jobs that we have lost in the United States that have gone to Mexico. But what you will really learn if you take a look at the numbers is while the United States may have lost between 10 and 11% of their manufacturing jobs, Mexico has lost about 11 or 12% of their manufacturing jobs, so has China. What businesses are doing, especially publicly traded businesses, companies, and I serve on three publicly traded boards, is that for people who own stock in their company, they have a responsibility to return shareholder value, which means, therefore, that they need to find the most efficient way to make a profit so that those who own stock in their companies are going to be able to get a return or a dividend on their investment. Thomas Friedman would say to you, if you would read his book, that you should not worry about this. What you really need to worry about is getting the best education humanly possible. Why? Because if you would have listened to Governor Granholm a couple of years ago at her State of the State message, she observed that no longer is it acceptable for anybody just to graduate from high school. Well, you say, well, why is that? Because you can't find a decent job anymore just coming out of high school. That you at least need a two-year associate degree out of any of our outstanding community colleges, but it would be better for you to get a four-year college education. Well, why? Because the difference between a high school graduate today and a person who graduates from a four-year college is $1 million over their lifetime. That's called security. That's called working and earning a living. I mean, my parents' friends who dropped out of high school, some, even some of my friends who dropped out of high school could go to work in an automobile plant and successfully make a living and be able to have a middle class household, put their kids through college if their children wanted to go, perhaps have a recreational vehicle or a cottage up north, and they'd be able to have the kind of quality life. That does not exist anymore. If you talk to President Ron Gettelfinger of the International UAW, or if you talk to James Hoffa of the Teamsters, they will tell you that in order to be competitive in this world, you need a college education. You cannot step into the same jobs that the men and women who are doing a great job working in our automobile plants today have, because you need that kind of education. Well, what does that have to do with you? It has everything to do with you. When I was growing up in Cassopolis and didn't have anything and had to go outside to the bathroom, whether it was 90 degrees or 40 below wind chill factor or snow up to my knees, because Cassopolis is in a snow belt, I never thought for once, I never even envisioned myself being a teacher. I couldn't even contemplate thinking about being a lawyer. And to be on the state's highest court, That was never in my frame of reference. I couldn't even dream it because I've never been exposed to it. And to be mayor of the city of Detroit, at the time the 10th largest city in the United States, president of the American Bar Association, over 430,000 members, being part of a profession that has 1.1 million licensed lawyers, which about 800,000 of us actually practice law, and the others use their talents to be investment bankers and the like. That was something that I could not envision. Why do I tell you that? Because you may not have a vision right now of what you want to be or what you can be. But I will tell you this, unless you get a good education, you won't make it. And guess what else? There are kids all over Michigan who have teachers who are educating their students to have a dream and to get the jobs that you might even think that you want. But guess what? It doesn't stop just in Michigan. We got 50 states in the United States. All over the United States, in schools just like yours, these young people are being educated. Those who will listen to their parents, those who will listen to their teachers. They're not trying to break your face when they say, are you doing homework? Do you have tests to take tomorrow? Or they give you a test? They want you to be competitive. Why? Because it doesn't stop in the United States. You've got kids in Japan who go to school longer hours so that they can be competitive, so they can take the jobs that you think you want, because this world is flat and people from all over work everywhere. The same is true in all of the countries throughout the world. If you're going to be a leader, if you just want to be an individual and you want to be successful, if you want a shot at doing something, I will tell you, if you watch what goes on in the world of politics, if you ever think that you might want to be an elected official, please make sure you are squeaky clean. And if you got a brother or sister who's just born, make sure that they stay squeaky clean for the rest of their life. Because if you do anything, I don't care what it is, that's wrong, it will come back to haunt you. And by the way, don't have a bad memory. If you watch television and you watch the news, you will have seen, I think, today on the Today Show, where, or maybe it was yesterday, where Senator Clinton, in one of her speeches, for example, was talking about how she was in Bosnia. Bosnia is a country, by the way, that wasn't a country when I was your age. When the Berlin Wall came down and when communism went down, these are countries that with new names have come up. But when she went there, she reminisced of how she was ducking from sniper fire. It turns out that there was no sniper fire. It turns out that she had made a mistake, that in truth, her daughter Chelsea was with her. She got off and walked around the area. There was a young girl there who read her a poem and kissed her on both sides of the cheek. There was no sniper fire. And they had cameras just like here. They had media that went with her because she was the first lady of the United States, married to President Clinton at the time. You can't make mistakes. At least mistakes that will penalize you. One of the things that I learned from my parents, and I learned in law school, and I learned when I became a member of the Michigan Supreme Court, was that ethics are absolutely important. Ethics meaning you respect one another. Whether you read the Quran or the Bible or the Torah or whatever, it's how you treat each other. It's how you respect one another. You know, if you think about it, there's been a lot of discussion about race. When I grew up in Cassopolis, we had a one block long main street. They had a grocery store on one side of the street, grocery store on another side of the street, almost opposite, equal. You know, one walk out of one, right across the street to the other. We had two banks. We had a bakery. Do you know, on that one block long main street, despite the fact that Cassopolis and Cass County was a stop on the Underground Railroad, there was not a person who worked behind the counter or owned a store that was a person of color. I didn't meet the first African-American professional until Clarence Lusby became our math teacher when I was in 11th grade. You all are very blessed, whether you appreciate it or not, to have classmates who come from different parts of the world parents, etc., who have different cultures, who have made outstanding contributions to world and American civilization. When I went to college, I had a chance to be exposed to that. You have a beautiful chance to be exposed to the differences right now. You know, the world in which we live in, back in 1982 and 83, there are professionals called demographers and social scientists. And they predicted that because of birth rate and because of the relaxation of immigration rules, that the majority of the people living in the United States by the year 2056 will be people of color. They also said that the largest single ethnic minority group in the United States would be the Hispanic population. In 2003, the United States Census Department said that the Hispanic population was the largest population in the United States at about 13.2%. African Americans about 12.6%. In 2004, the United States Census Department said that the Hispanic and the Asian population would triple in size by the year 2050, and that the non-white Hispanic population, meaning whites, would represent 50.1% of America's population, which confirms what the demographers and the social scientists were talking about in 1982 and 83, that by 2056, that the majority of people living in the United States would be people of color. I'm very concerned about that. I'm concerned not because of the change of demographics, which also means when people register and they vote, that you're not going to hear or read about the first person of color to be mayor or governor or whatever. That is going to be commonplace. What I'm concerned about is, what are we doing? Rather, what are you doing to be ready to take on the responsibility that's going to be entrusted to you? I mean, if you think about it, your parents, myself, even your teachers, those who work, those who do such a great job trying to raise you and trying to educate you and the like, and what you read about in terms of what's going on in our federal government in Washington, in the House and the Senate and the President, in Lansing, what occurs in our legislature, in the House and the Senate, the governor's office. If you don't like it, then what are you doing to get ready to do something about it? It's not going to be handed to you. You're going to have to be ready to do that. If you think that you want to invent something, if you think you want to create something, if you think you want to do something, you've got to be ready for it. Because if you're not ready for it, somebody will snatch it and take it away from you because you're not prepared to lead. You're not prepared to go to work unless you get a good education and a good foundation. You've got a responsibility. The fun and games are over. Your parents can ask you, your teachers can give you homework, your parents can ask you, have you got it done, have you studied for it, but you know better than anybody whether or not you've done your homework. And I will tell you this, that makes a big difference in terms of what kind of grades you receive. Because you see, when you come out of high school, whatever high school you graduate from, your grades will depend upon where you go to college. Your grades will determine whether or not you will have a full scholarship to go to college or to a university of your choice. Right now, we have funds that are able to give our students who graduate from high school, who go to a four-year college or a two-year community college, $4,000 towards that amount. But trust me, that doesn't cover all the costs. So what are you doing about getting good grades? And if you think you want to be a professional beyond getting a four-year college degree, if you want to do something that is special. Teacher, lawyer, doctor, scientist, you've got to get a good education. And guys, let me just close with this. If you ever make the mistake of underestimating the brilliance, the tenacity, and the intellectual ability of a woman, you will lose every time. I don't care what you do, you will lose. Let me tell you, young ladies, about what's going on right now in this world. Right now in the United States, women start more businesses than men. Women have 10.8 million businesses in the United States. Women own businesses today, hire more people than the Fortune 500 companies combined. Women own businesses today generate about $1.9 trillion in sales. And guys, you will also learn that women make 82% of all consumer purchases. There are companies in this world. I sit on three publicly traded boards. I sit on Masco, CompuWare, Johnson Controls. Johnson Controls is one of 14 companies that do $1 billion a year with women-owned and minority-owned companies. Johnson Controls this year will do about $2 billion worth of business with women and minority-owned firms. But you see, I also serve on a employment practices advisory panel along with two other very brilliant, outstanding women, one a lawyer, a partner in her law firm, a Latina out in California, and she sits on four publicly traded boards, and the other is not a lawyer, but she's a former and the first three-star general in the United States Army who was responsible for managing 45,000 people as she ran the Army Intelligence Department. The three of us serve on the Employment Practices Advisory Panel for Walmart. We advise them on gender and diversity issues. Walmart spends $4.2 billion a year with women and minority-owned vendors. And they've just started a new program that's going to increase that spend. You have every opportunity to succeed. The only thing that will be in your way will be you. You can take advantage of every opportunity that comes before you, or you can lay back and be a loser. The thing that disturbs me about what has happened in the United States is that today, and I think about, if you remember, I told you that I was concerned about the future. There's 2.1 million people today in our federal and in our state's prisons. That's 25% of the world's imprisoned population. You count up all the countries. Remember I said China's got 1.3 billion people? We have more people with 300 million people in our nation's prisons, state and federal prisons. And what bothers me tragically about that is that 40% of those who are in these prisons are African Americans, and 23 to 25% are Hispanics. That's about 63 to 65%. And today, those two populations combined is about 27%. And there are more women going into prisons today than are men. So I don't want you to be a statistic. That's why I came here today. What I want you to be is a winner. But the only person who controls that is you. Your parents have taught you well. Your teachers have taught you well in terms of responsibility, ethics and how to respect one another. You know what is right and wrong. And you know if you pick up and smoke a marijuana cigarette and somebody sees you, over. You do something that's wrong, it's over. You drink and drive and have a record, it's over. And what do I mean by that? You almost have to be squeaky clean to advance. If you ever think that you'd like to work in a State Department, to go any country to represent the United States, to be an ambassador, if you think you'd like to be a United States Congressman, a United States Senator, a governor, or whatever the case may be, if you want to be a professional, they check into your background. If there's a choice to be made to somebody who is squeaky clean and somebody who's got a record or somebody who's been a jerk all their life and doesn't know how to respect people, guess who's not getting the job? You've got a chance to be a winner. It's all up to you. But I'm betting on you. And I'm betting on your parents who care deeply about you. You have every opportunity to get along and to learn from one another. The United States can be stronger by working together collegially, to learn from one another, to respect one another's and the like. If you read our Constitution, we respect each other's religion. We respect each other as we should. That's what we're supposed to be. But if you violate that right and the privilege, you not only hurt yourself, but you hurt America. You are old enough to know different now, and there's no excuse. I wish for you every success. Thank you.
On behalf of the students at Edsel Ford High School and Dearborn Public Schools, we want to present you with this plaque thanking you for coming today and being such a wonderful role model. And we have a little pin, and it's a compass. And I want to thank you for kind of sending our students off in the right direction.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I hope you look that all right. Thank you. I'm going to run. I got to go
That's
work.
That's okay. Thank you.
I now have a day job. I got to go work. I'll see you later.
Okay. We have another very famous mayor here. And it's our own mayor, Jack O'Reilly. And if he could come up here for a moment. I got nervous with Mayor Dennis Archer. It was very moving. I was almost at a loss for words. I'd like to introduce you, for those of you who don't know our mayor. This is Jack O'Reilly. Some of you, if you're in sports, may have heard of his sons, who I'm very proud of, Sean and Dylan O'Reilly. They're wonderful athletes, and they have played in the city. And so I would like to introduce, or I'm introducing our mayor, but I would like him to speak just a few minutes on leadership, and then we're going to have a panel discussion.
Right.
Is that good, Mayor?
Very good.
Okay.
Thanks, Jackie. I have to clarify, since Jackie mentioned only one thing, I'm proud of my children for everything they do, and Jackie knows they've been involved with STAND, they've done summer STAND mentoring, they've been a part of that, but they're also both National Honor Society students, student council students, they serve, they've chaired their blood drives. They both have been in the chorus and the vocal impressions, and they've both been in school plays. So they're well-rounded, which is one of the things I think that we're here to talk about, is that you have to be a balanced and well-rounded person. You want to explore your interests, because one of the key things is, until you try something, you're not going to know if it fits, feels right. And you're not going to know if you have a passion about it. And one of the key things that I always talk about, if you really want to know how to be successful in life. It's figure out what you have a passion about. What do you really care about? What really is important to you? And make your career around that, because you will be successful. Because the driving force, the thing that will drive you, is that passion. And that will be what it is. But you have to have opportunities to explore that. You have to have experiences to explore it. And that's a lot about it. Mayor Archer spoke about The World is Flat, which is a great book. Another book that I really hope people would read. How many here have read Genome by Mark Ridley? Anybody had to read it? Genome is an interesting book because it talks about the Human Genome Project, where they basically broke down and began to discover all that they could about the human genes. And Mark Ridley is a science writer, so what he does, he takes this thing, says, I'm not a scientist, and if it were in scientific language and it was very complex, I wouldn't be able to successfully absorb the book. But one of the things is that he takes it and he breaks it down, the 23 chromosomes, into characteristics that really define who we are as a people. And the thing that's most compelling when you read this, and there's a lot of great information in there, but one of the things that's most compelling is that there's so little differences between all of us. I mean minute differences in the scheme of things. But the thing about those differences is that we are all unique. Now, however you look at it, with the Creator, but we are unique. And when you came to this room today, even though you're from the same school, so you all see each other in school all the time, or perceivably do. Some you don't notice. Sometimes you don't even notice people in the room. But when you come into a room as a human, the first thing you're doing is looking at everybody to see, who do you know? Who do I know? Who am I connected with? Okay? That's the first thing you're doing when you enter a room like this, when you came in this morning. All right? And how is it that you define who you're going to sit with, or who you're going to congregate with, who you're going to stop and say hi? People you recognize and you know. But the key thing is, how do we know them? How do you know who that person is? When you walk in a room, say you're going to a joint thing where there's lots of schools. You go to something where there's all kinds of people. You're looking to see, who do I know? Okay? You know them because they're unique. You know that when you look into their face, you can identify them from everybody else in the room. Okay? How amazing is that? That no matter where you go in the world, no matter what environment you're in, everybody is unique. Everybody is different enough that you'll know whether you know them or whether there's somebody you've never met before. Now, if that's just what we see physically, characteristically, how amazing is what's inside that person? And yet we blow them off. We ignore that all the time. And if you understand the genome and what makes us human, you're going to realize incredible capacity. Now, one of the things we're going to talk about, and we're going to get to the panel because I don't want to just talk, but one of the things we're going to talk about is leadership. And the key to leadership is not the title. That means nothing. The key to leadership, nor is it my vision. I'm the leader. Now I'm going to set the vision. I'm going to tell everybody what to do. Unsuccessful. Won't work. Leadership is trying to figure out what are the best assets of the team you lead, each individual's best assets, and then bringing them together toward a common goal. That's leadership and that's success. You have to help each member of your team identify what they are best at, what they can best contribute, and then you have to bring that all toward a common goal, a common vision. And it can't be your vision and your goal because it won't mean anything to them. It has to be their goal, their vision shared. That's, to me, the true definition of leadership. And everybody has the capacity to do it, and everybody will have the opportunity in their lifetime to do it. And whether you're capable or not will depend on whether you're ready and whether you're willing to look beyond just what you see on the surface and discover who is that person within each individual. So we're going to go to the panel, but I did want to introduce Councilman George Duraney is here with us today. And I know Sine Barry, I don't know if he's been introduced, but our head of our Board of Realtors. I'm sure have you been introduced? Sharon and Dr. Artis and everybody. So again, it's a pleasure to be here. I look forward to your questions, the panel discussion. I think what you want to know is going to be much more important to us. But I really want you to begin to think about looking beyond the surface and trying to discover what's inside other people, especially teams. One question I have. How many of you had team projects where, say, four or five students worked on a project they had to hand in together, right? Now, how many cases was it some person sort of took the lead, but by taking the lead, they basically did the project, and everybody else just sort of sat back? How many times does that happen? Okay. That's the problem. You weren't a leader. The person who did the project for the team may have thought, boy, I stood up. I was a leader. I took leadership and I did the job. Wrong. You weren't a leader. The leader would have engaged everybody because you'd have had a better end product. That's it.
Thank you, Mayor.